Tonight we're gonna begin by recapping. It's been, you know, I know you guys hear this a lot from me. You know, I always say that, oh no, this is my favorite series. Oh no, this is my favorite series. I love the Word of God, and I love seeing how it transforms lives. And one of the ways that I love seeing it transforming lives is when we take the Word and we make it so practical and so simplistic the way Jesus did, that we can apply it to so many areas of our lives. And I can tell you this, I've heard more testimonies from the past week, just life-changing testimonies of what God's doing in people's relationships and priorities and finances. This has been such an exciting series. And I want to recap it because some of you, we've got people that have started coming to the church halfway through it and they missed the other parts, and some of you may have been out of town. So I want to do a quick recap what we've talked about this month. We've talked about, first of all, keeping our priorities in balance and the importance of living out your priorities, your God-given priorities and your God-given values, those things that make up who you are, and how important it is to take those things that make up the very essence, the very nature and the character of who you are, and to live those things out, and how to protect your priorities from getting out of balance. Because how many of you know when priorities are out of balance, it's the fundamental part of all of it. Everything is out of balance. So we started off by talking about the importance of taking our priorities and keeping them in balance. In fact, what I did is I put some of the keys that we talked about. In order to keep things in balance, there's two really important things we need to do. The first is to evaluate expectations, because the reality is we all live under expectations. If you've ever worked in a plant, there's expectations, aren't there? I was talking to one of our retired GM workers the other day, and they were talking about those expectations that they used to work under, that line was coming. And buddy, you had to get your part on that car, because if you didn't get your part on the car, you messed everything up. And there was all these expectations of what to produce and what to create. And it doesn't matter if you're at a GM factory, it's anywhere. If you're a worker, or if you're a mom or a dad or a husband or a wife, if you're just a person, a man or a woman, if you're retired, working still, it doesn't matter what you are, there's expectations. And there's three expectations that we constantly have to evaluate. The first is the ones from others, the expectations people put on you. And everybody knows what that's like. You're putting expectations on me. I'm putting expectations on you. We have this system of expectations upon one another. But we've also got to evaluate what is God's expectation. And for God's expectation, two key things have to happen. One, we've got to go to the Word of God. Two, we've got to go to the presence of God. God, what is your expectation for my life? What do you want for my life? What do you want me to do today? Not just tomorrow, a week from now, or a year from now, but God, what is your will for my life right now? We've constantly got to evaluate those expectations. And then the third expectation is yourself. I don't know about you, but I put high expectations on myself sometimes. There's people that put low expectations. One of the things that we joke around about is if you set the bar really low, it's kind of easy to achieve. So just keep the bar right there. Well, Dad, all I need to get is a D to pass. Well, that's kind of low. Let's get that bar up, you know. All I got to do is just do enough work so I can get off when the bell rings. No, let's bring the bar up. All I've got to do is read just enough of the Bible, and I'll be close enough to God. But the reality is that we've got to evaluate what those expectations we're putting on ourselves. Are they too high? Are they too low? Are they unrealistic? The second thing we need to do is we've got to prioritize our values. And we talked about, I simplified it. Now, everybody's values look different. In fact, if you were in the Wednesday night class where we really unpacked this, I unpacked it in such a way where you saw my seven values. Now, to simplify it, we simplified it with love God, love people, love life. And how important it is to prioritize those things. That when we start loving life so much and loving things to do and loving our hobbies and loving our events and loving hanging out with people and friends and family, when we love in life so much that we put it over God, things are out of balance. And when we love God so much that we completely don't never take time to love the life or the people around us that He's placed in our world, then we're out of balance. That a simple way of looking at it is to love God, love people, and then take the time to love life. Keeping those priorities in balance will make for a much happier life. The second week we talked about relationships. Boy, I love talking about relationships. And we talked about how we've all got these unhealthy relationships, all of us. Somewhere, sometime in our past, our present, we'll probably have them in our future. There's always going to be an imbalance in our relationship where maybe we're surrounded by bad influences, or maybe we're surrounded by needy people or negative people. Anybody ever known somebody negative? Just pure negativity, just all the time. How many of you are sitting next to that person right now? Just slightly put your hand up so I know. Just put your hand down, Barbara. You know what it's like, those people that are just, they're just negative, or they're just discouraging, or what. We've all been in those seasons of life, so how do we keep our relationships in balance? Well, it's very important. I gave you those three things. That first, you need to have someone you can follow. I was amazed by how many people told me after that service, Pastor, I really don't know who I'm following. I look up to my mom or my dad, but I don't have a great relationship. We all should have someone actively pouring into our lives at all times. Jesus said, follow me as I follow Christ. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. That would have been awkward the other way around. Paul says this because he understands that we all need to have somebody that we're looking towards. And I understand that Jesus is the person we're always looking towards. But having that other person that's imitating Christ in today's day in and day out things makes life a lot easier. And I was shocked at how many people said, Pastor, I don't have anybody I'm following right now. The second relationship that needs to be in check is having someone you can walk with. And the importance of having someone you can walk with through life. Someone that's kind of at the same place. Someone that can encourage you and provoke you. You know, the Word of God says, as iron sharpens iron. Somebody that's there to lift you up when you fall down. We all need those people. And the third relationship, and an even harder one, is someone we can mentor. Shortly after that service, I went to Poncho's because that's where I always go on Sundays, every Sunday. And I was at Poncho's, and I come in, and the first thing I do is we say how many we need for a table, and then I walk around and I say hey to all the church people, because, you know, the majority of our church people go to Poncho's. So it's like having another service at Poncho's. So I go around and I'm talking to everybody, and I love the fact that a couple of the tables I walked up to were having this conversation, and they were asking one another, who are we mentoring? Who are we pouring into? Because the Word of God tells us that we are supposed to give to the next generation. That we're supposed to pour out and set the next generation up for success. But so often, we never take the time to actively, proactively put someone in our lives that we can pour into. And it doesn't matter how old or how young you are. You can mentor somebody as a 10-year-old just as much as you can mentor somebody as a 90-year-old. We should always have somebody in our lives that we're pulling along with us. Having those three in balance will lead to relationships, being in between the lines. Last week we talked about finances, and I will go quickly, I promise, for those of you that are like, man, this will be a long night. I promise, we're good. Last week we talked about finances, and I can tell you this, I was really nervous. I didn't want to tell our Sunday morning crowd this, okay? So I'm going to tell the Sunday night crowd. I was really nervous about last week because I told you, whenever you talk about finances, you have a really low crowd. And when you talk about finances, people get upset. And people start getting kind of, don't talk about my money. You can talk about my wife. You can talk about my husband. You can talk about my kids. Don't talk about my money because that's my money. Preacher, stay up off my money, you know. And I was so nervous going into that service. And there was so much spiritual attack all week long. Because anytime you talk about money, the enemy's going to attack. That's why Jesus talked about money. Second most talked about subject in the Bible. He talks about money because it's important. And I can tell you that of all the weeks thus far, there are more powerful testimonies that have come out of last week of any service we've had at this church. People that are reevaluating, reassessing, recommitting their lives to healthy finances, to tithing, to giving. And last week we talked about the key to keep it in balance because we've all been there. We had a good time at our life group. Man, that was... Honestly, I really thought that was going to be a rough night. The people were not going to want to talk, but it was the most talkative night at our life group. And we were talking about some of the stupid mistakes we've made in our past and what seasons of our lives looked like when our finances were just completely out of balance. And it was so encouraging because what I saw was a group of people that are sharing life together, just like me, that are wanting to keep or get their finances into the balance that God wants. And to do so, there's 10 quick things that we need to keep in mind. Remembering that God creates wealth. No matter how much you work at it, no matter what you do, it's God's. That we should be content and be thankful for what we've got. We were talking, that was probably, let me rewind because many of you don't go to life groups. I asked the question. And one of the life group questions was, which one of these is the hardest for you. And contentment was the one that the most people said. That, Pastor, it's hard for me to be content with what I've got. I'm always wanting something else, something new, something bigger or faster. But the Word of God teaches us to be content in all things. Number three, we've got to guard against greed. Be thankful for what we've got. Having more and more and more. It's not that money is evil. It's the love of all money. Number four, give thanks to God. Taking time to be thankful for what He's blessed us with. Five, get out of debt. That was a tough one. People don't like hearing that. But you know what? I think they're catching it. Richard, I think they're catching it, man, because there's 60-some people that are signed up for Financial Peace University. People want to get out of debt. People want to get their finances back at being healthy. Number six, count the cost of your spending. Don't buy something you can't afford. Don't spend money on something that's not a necessity and has not been thought out thoroughly. Seven, save to give. And we talked about the importance of being able to pass down to your children's children. A dear brother in our church recently passed away, and he left a large sum of money to this church for missions. And he's giving in such a way that it's the children's 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 children. Should the Lord tarry, there's no telling how many lives are going to be changed with the dollars that he gave. Save to give. Eight, put God before money. And how often we forget that it's all God's in the first place. And that when we don't stop to go, hey, God, this is your money. What would you like me to do with it? And instead, we assume, God, this is my money. So bless what I just bought. But God says, no, put God before money. Number nine, tithe. Oh, glory. Any tithers in the house? Tithe. Give your 10% to the storehouse. We talked about what the storehouse is and what it's set up for and what it's meant for. Number 10, get godly counsel. And that was one that I can tell you, my life group, we got hung up on talking about. Because it's so amazing to me is how few of us in this room have someone that we go to for godly counsel. Someone that we can go to and say, hey, help me with my budget. Teach me how to do these finances better. Help hold me accountable with tithing. Guide me through this. This morning we talked about Christian living, living out the lifestyle that God called us to live. We talked about the key is to pursue godly wisdom, to pursue godly friendships, to set ourselves up for success by the people we put around ourselves. To pursue godly mentors, men or women of God that we can look up to that are living lives of holiness, lives of righteousness that have got it together, if you will. Not perfect people, but people that have it together. We talked about the importance of pursuing godly opportunities in order to set ourselves up for success. Number five, we talked about pursuing holiness and what true holiness is. It's being set apart. It's consecrated. It's not faking it till you make it and acting like Sister Maribel over here that's got her bun. It's not. That's not holiness. Holiness, not that that's not holiness, but holiness is pursuing God in greater levels of righteousness, greater levels of conviction. In fact, I ask you to do me a favor and go home and ask yourself a hard question. Ask God a hard question as well. God, can you convict me over something new? God, can you increase the level of conviction in my life? Can you take it to another level? Can you convict me over something that others may seem silly? But God, can you raise the level of conviction because I've gotten stagnant? I've reached a level of holiness, if you will, from the things that the world has told me is wrong or the church has told me that's wrong, but I want to go to the next level. Thank you for those of you that have not been making fun of me about my conviction I shared this morning. And if I find out any of you are leaving buggies out in the parking lot because you see me in the parking lot, I'm going to get you, okay? Don't be doing that to me now. We talked about this morning, the key to everything is the fear and trembling. That convictions aren't just found haphazardly. That holiness and righteousness doesn't just happen. The Word of God says, search out your own salvation with fear and trembling. We should be scared to death of the process. There's an old joke that my friends and I and some pastors, we used to have. I don't want to go to hell on a technicality. Now, of course, I don't believe that. I believe we're covered by grace. But fear and trembling means I want to get it right, and I'm going to do everything I can to get it right because I don't want to mess it up. I want to do the very best that I can because it's my King. Tonight, I want to kind of bring it all together. Tonight, each week is standalone in itself. But tonight, for this group, I want us to bring it together. I want to paint a picture over these next few moments of what it really looks like and what the overall need in order to keep it in between the lines is really all about. And to do so, we're going to talk about Solomon. Maybe you've heard of Solomon. He's Old Testament king, the son of David. Solomon became the king. Many of you may not know this. At age 12, any 12-year-olds in the house? Do I have a 12-year-old? I got a 12-year-old here. Any other 12-year-olds? Y'all are close back there, aren't you guys? My son's close. Can you imagine a 12-year-old getting elected president of the United States of America? Now, you may say they'd probably do a better job. That's between you and yourself. But could you imagine waking up one morning and finding out a 12-year-old boy was just elected the president of the great United States of America? Well, at the time when Solomon, not elected as king, but chosen as king after his father passed away, he started ruling Israel, which was the greatest nation. And he ruled it for 40 years until he died at a young age of 52. Before his father David turns the kingdom over to him, before he gives him the keys to the kingdom, he gives him some final words of wisdom about living a balanced life. Now, we're talking about David. We talked about him that first week. This is the David that saw the girl on the rooftop, if you know what I'm saying. Trying to be careful with little ears tonight. But David is the one that messed up with the girl. You remember Bathsheba? David was the one that should have been out fighting the battle, but instead he finds himself hiding in his home, sleeping till noon, getting up, walking around, looking at things he shouldn't have looked at, taking things as his own that he shouldn't. David was a guy that was out of balance, and just like any good father, many of you would probably do the same thing. He sits down with his son Solomon at 12 years old and says, Solomon, I want to give you a couple things that are going to help you be successful. Your dad, your good old dad, as much as God loved me, as much as God called me a man after his own heart, I had some stuff that was out of balance. So in the final words of David, he says, man, let me give you some advice. And in 1 Kings 2, verse 2 and 3, it says this: I am about to go to the way of all the earth. Be strong and show yourself a man. Time out right there. That's just kind of a cool thing to say. David's about to pass away and he looks at his son. He says, man up. Okay? That's good advice. Man up. And keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his statutes, his commandments, his rules, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you turn. And then he hands over the keys to the kingdom to his 12-year-old boy. He wraps up everything in these last few words. Son, man up. Son, follow the Lord. Follow his ways. Keep his commandments. I got out of balance. Don't be like me, son. Be better than me, son. He hands him over to Solomon. He passes away. And then Solomon ruled during what was known as Israel's most peaceful and prosperous years. Solomon's wisdom of the Torah and secular wisdom was known throughout the world. Solomon was at the top of his game in the greatest nation the world had ever seen. This is the pinnacle of Jewish history. Everyone is united. Their neighbors don't bother the Jews. In fact, they come to learn from the Jews. There is peace and prosperity. This is as good as it gets for Israel, the closest ancient Israel gets to achieving the messianic ideal of creating an ideal nation. That is a light to all the other nations. This is the zenith, if you will, the top, the crux. This is the best of the best. So why doesn't it last? Well, Solomon makes one serious mistake. In violation of the Torah, prohibition, he takes too many wives. In fact, he had 700 wives. What was he thinking? Brother, 700? You know, one's enough for me. I have a great wife, but one's enough. She deserves better than me. I give all I can to one. 700? But that wasn't enough because he also had 300 concubines. That is 1,000. If you're doing the math, it's a little overkill, don't you think? That's a good time, husbands, that's a good time to say, oh yeah, that's too much. One would have been enough. 1,000. And if we go back to the book of Deuteronomy, where the idea that the Jews would one day want a king is first discussed, Moses warns that the king should not have too many horses or too many wives. Horses and wives, what a combination. But hey, it's the Old Testament. What are you going to do? The great Torah commentator Rashi tells us that this means no more than 18. So when the Bible was saying, you know, Moses saying you shouldn't have too many wives, it's saying, you know, 18's probably enough. Can I just say again, 18's probably too many? That's my professional advice, take it or leave it. So the Torah places this limit And they place the limits so that the king can stay focused on his responsibilities and not be distracted and corrupted by materialism and power. And Solomon was certainly aware of these prohibitions. But he felt that his great wisdom and spirituality would enable him to handle these challenges and be an even greater king. Solomon, like so many others, started off right, but found himself on the same journey we find ourselves on. A journey of discovery that usually leads to imbalance. I mean, think about it. You've got a guy that is living the best life. He's balanced. His dad has left him with something successful that he can build on. He gives him this great father-son talk about, son, keep it in between the lines. Keep it balanced. And within a few years, Solomon is taken what was so balanced and got it so out of whack. And when you look at Solomon's journey, you can see that his priorities start to slip. He starts out with such a beautiful conversation with God in 1 Corinthians 3:7. I want to read this for you. And now, O Lord, my God, you have made your servant king in place of David, my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this, and God said to him, because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind so that none like you has ever been before and none like you shall ever arise after. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that no other king shall compare with you all of your days. Now, let's put this into perspective. Imagine, if you will, that the creator of the universe wakes you up at night with a powerful voice and says, Erwin, what would you like? Linda, what can I give you? That's my best God voice. That's all I can do. Now, you may be really amazing person, and you may, the first thing you pop off is going to be, peace on earth, goodwill to men. That all should be saved. And those are great things. But usually the first thing that pops in people's mind, especially in the middle of the night, is something stupid. Hey, a car would be great. New job. How about you get so-and-so off my back? Could you make my wife a little bit nicer? Could you make my husband a little smarter? You know, I don't know what it would be that you would ask for, but I'm willing to bet that you would ask for something. And here is a 12-year-old. What 12-year-old, when awakened by God, asks for knowledge? A guy that has his priorities straight. Most 12-year-olds I know would ask for stuff. I know I would have at 12. Or am I the only one? Ask a 12-year-old, you can have anything you want. What is it? It's not going to be make me smarter. How about an iPod, God? But here's a 12-year-old boy. You know what that tells me? What that speaks to me is that here's a young man, 12 years old, that had his priorities straight, had a father who invested and instilled these great things in his life, but yet his priorities were to lead how the Lord wanted him to, and then it quickly changed. See, it changed to an emphasis on wealth and women. What started out so balanced so quickly changed. His relationships got out of balance. I just told you a moment ago, I'm not going to read the scripture, but in 1 Kings 11, you see where it talks about all the different wives he had. Most of them were political arrangements, and most of them were with people groups that the word of God prohibited and said the king, the Jews, should not intermarry with these, and yet he did it anyway because it made political sense. He stepped outside and got out of balance. And when he did, they started speaking things into his ears, and he turned his heart from God. This is the same guy that wrote the Song of Solomon, but yet his relationships became so very unbalanced. Even his relationship with his son, the one he should be pouring into, the one he should be mentoring, the one he should be developing, even his relationship with his son became unhealthy. And then it spiraled even greater out of control. His finances got unbalanced. In 1 Kings chapter 10, you see an entire excerpt, if you will. Almost 20 verses giving us an account of all that he had. Listen, when it takes a chapter just to explain your stuff, that's a lot of stuff. Give me a little napkin from Crystals and I could probably fill up half of it. A whole chapter in the Bible of just his stuff. And it's not that the stuff was bad, but what became bad is his love for stuff and more riches and more wealth. And we know 1 Timothy 6:10 says, for the love of money is the root. It's not bad to love money, but it becomes the root of all kinds of evils when we fall in love with it. It's this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. That was Solomon. Living on top, having it all together. And then losing it all at the same time. And in the midst of this, Solomon learns something powerful. He learns perspective. Now, I accidentally already filled that in your notes. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to circle it. I want you to underline it. I want you to put a star, put a smiley face, whatever you need to do. I want you to look at that word perspective. Because when we're talking about balance, we're talking about keeping it between the lines, the key always comes back to this one word, perspective. Perspective is the key to everything. And in fact, when I think about perspective, I think about this guy named Solomon who had it all. And shortly before his death, he wrote a book of the Bible called Ecclesiastes. Have you heard of it? Quite difficult to spell, by the way. In the book of Ecclesiastes, if you've ever read it, what you basically read is a cantankerous, complaining man riddling off his soapbox. Anybody know somebody cantankerous? We got a few people in here, a little cantankerous. Just kidding. We don't. You know what a cantankerous person sounds like, don't you? They're just upset about everything. Wow, what a beautiful day it is. Look at these blue skies. Well, I'm getting sunburned. Cantankerous. They're not happy about anything. They're not just negative. They take negativity to another level. In fact, they take negativity to a level because it becomes so personal. They're cantankerous. Nothing makes them happy. Nothing rubs them the right way. In fact, they're just frustrated with everything. I remember sitting down with someone that was known for just extreme negativity. And I asked him the question, is there anything you're happy about? No. Nope. That conversation didn't last very long. Because when somebody is that negative and that cantankerous, there's nothing that makes them happy. In fact, just everything's a mess. Everything. In reality, is we've probably been there at some point in our lives where we've just felt fed up and thrown your hands in there and just said, forget it all. Burn it all to the ground and let God sort it out. I'm done. We've all been there. But not many of us write a book about it. But yet Solomon did. Solomon, in all his wisdom and all his grandeur and all his possessions and all his wives and all the success that the world said he realized his life was out of balance and his perspective changed. The man who said, if I could ask God for one thing, it would be for wisdom, had his perspective changed. The man who said, if I could just have more wives and more political alliances, his perspective changed. The man who said, if I could just have more wealth, his perspective changed. And we see it all in Ecclesiastes. In fact, what I'd like to do for these next few moments is I want to point out some things that Solomon teaches us about perspective. That if we're going to try to live our lives by keeping it in between the lines and finding this balance, then we've got to take the time to assess our perspective in the way we're viewing life. And when I look at Solomon, one of the things that I see that he teaches us is, number one, eternal value versus earthly vanity. Eternal value versus earthly vanity. See, vanity means an excessive pride or admiration of one's own appearance or achievements. But there's another definition. That definition is the one we see used in Ecclesiastes. That definition of a vanity means the quality of being worthless or futile. It's just a waste of good atoms. You with me? And we see in Ecclesiastes this perspective change of Solomon, who was all about stuff and all about achievements. He says in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, vanity of vanities, other way of saying that, worthlessness of worthlessness. It sounds more cantankerous when you say it that way. Worthlessness of worthlessness, says the preacher, worthless of worthlessness, all is worthless. What does man gain by all the toil at which he toils under the sun? A generation and a generation goes, a generation comes, but the earth remains forever. It's just worthless. Now, it would be really easy just to assume that Ecclesiastes is nothing more than a guy's soapbox venting about life. But if that's all it was, can we agree with something? Why is it in the Bible? How did it make it through the canon process? Is it an inspired word of God? Absolutely. This is more than just a soapbox. This is more than just a man trying to clear out his conscience, get some stuff off his chest. This is so much more. This is a guy that's saying, I've learned something in the process of figuring out balance. And what I've learned is that eternal value versus earthly vanity. That no matter how hard I work for stuff, it's worthless compared to what's eternal. You see, it's a perspective. When you look at finances through that perspective, here's a good example. And things tend to be out of balance with our finances. And they're just totally out of whack. And things just aren't going the way they're going. And then you stop and you look. How much money have I spent on stuff that will be left here when I die? Stuff that will rot, it will rust, it will mildew, it will lose its value. It's a waste. Versus how much have I spent and given to eternal things? You know, when I stop and I think about stuff, there's nothing in my house that's going to last forever. There's nothing. There's nothing I've bought, no vehicle, no motorcycle, no brick, no mortar. There is nothing in my house that will last forever. In fact, if God forbid, if I was taken from my family now, it would all be sold quickly. And if the rapture came today, I wouldn't need this stuff anyway. Because it's earthly vanity. It's worthless. It has no true value. But what in our lives has eternal value? When I stop and I think about the people that have come to know Christ, the people that are in ministry, the thing that means probably the most to me besides my family is a list of individuals that are now in full-time ministry around the world, some missionaries, some worship pastors, some youth pastors, people that are carrying the gospel. It's a list of people that I've been able to lead to Christ one-on-one, family members, grandparents, brothers that I've been able to pray with and lead to Christ. See, that is an eternal value versus earthly vanity. It's all about perspective. Second thing that we see when we look at Solomon's words of truth is in Ecclesiastes 3:9. And what he teaches us is the beauty of seasons. The beauty of seasons. How many of you love winter? Let me see your hands. Oh, really? Okay, let's try that again. How many of you love the beauty of summer? Glory to God, get it here quickly. It's cold as... Y'all, I moved from Michigan to get away from this mess. It followed me. It won't leave me alone. We've all got seasons we enjoy over the others. Everybody's got a favorite season. Some people love winter. I had one of my best friends up in Michigan. He was always talking about how he hated how hot Michigan was. And I would look at him and go, dude, it's like negative 10 degrees. He goes, but it's negative 50 in the UP. That's Upper Peninsula. That's up real. That's like Canadian land. I go, why would you want that? He goes, dude, they have no cars. They ride snowmobiles everywhere. He needed to be delivered. Who lives like that when there's places like Hawaii? Glory to God, there's beaches and sand, not snow. But regardless, that's what he loved. See, what I've learned is that people have favorite seasons and they enjoy and they recognize the simple seasons of fall and winter and spring and summer. But what we don't always keep in our minds is the reality that there are seasons elsewhere. Seasons throughout our lives. In fact, Ecclesiastes 3:9 says this, what gain has the worker from his toil? I have seen the business that God has given to the children of men to be busy with. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put enmity into man's heart, yet so that he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. Because when we get the big picture, we forget that there's seasons. When you look at a house that's completed, you don't always think about the process that it went through to get there. When you look at someone who's retired and living the dream, you don't always see the process that they had to go to get there. We don't always see the process, and our perspective gets out of whack. Friends, when we're looking for balance and we're looking to keep things in between the lines, our perspective has to change. We've got to recognize that there's a season. The Word teaches us also in Ecclesiastes. There's a season for this and a season for that. A time to live, a time to die, a time to eat, a time to sleep. There's a season for everything. Friends, your lives have seasons. You'll go through seasons of, I like to call them valley seasons, where everything just seems like it's going wrong. And then you have the seasons when you're going up the mountain and you have that momentum. And then you get on the top of the mountain, you have this season where everything's going great, it just feels good. And then you go back down the mountain. And then you get in the valley and it's, oh, you're in the valley. But then you go back up the valley. See, God created seasons in our lives to keep us alive. We can't stay and sustain growth in areas of our lives 24/7. We have to go through seasons of pruning. We have to go through seasons of winter where we're tested. We have to go through seasons of spring where we grow. We have to go into the fall where we get picked up and the things of separation take place between the wheat and the chaff. We have to go through these processes. And we have to respect that there's a season. See, you may be in a season right now where your balance is under attack. Maybe the balance in your finances. Maybe the balance in your walk with Christ. Things are a little bit out of whack. To keep it into perspective, you have to look at it differently. Let me give you a good example. How many of you ever had seasons where everything spiritually felt like it was on fire? Just everything's going good. Man, the Word is good. Your prayer time's good. Oh, man, you just see God in everything. You're walking by, you see a rock, and you're like, whoo, the rocks will cry out glory. And it just, man, it's just good stuff all the time. Oh, none of y'all? Okay. Well, y'all get saved. You'll have those times. It's awesome. How many of you have been through those seasons where you go, God, I don't even hear you. Do you hear me? Hello, God, do you know that I exist? I'm reading this Bible and all I see are words and they make no sense. God, do you even know that I'm here? Anybody ever been in that season? It's a season. Because see, if we stay in the season where it's just, oh, glory to God, everything's great all the time, we never get tested. We never go through hard moments where the character and the nature of God has an opportunity to be pruned and grow and develop. So when we're looking at keeping it in between the lines, and as it relates to our relationship with Christ, we have to keep it into perspective that, yeah, it may seem like it's out of balance because things just don't seem good. That doesn't mean it's out of balance. It just means that you're in a different season. God is a God of seasons, and you study the Word from Genesis to Revelation, you see these cycles of seasons. And if we can recognize and keep them into perspective, we won't beat ourselves up when we're in a season that we don't like. It's all about perspective. Another thing that we see from Solomon that he teaches us is that evil exists. Oh, pastor, don't say that. You may be one of those here that you believe that evil exists. But we live in a country where 60% of Protestant believers claiming to know Christ Jesus do not believe Satan exists. 60%. Each generation that increases. Evil exists. In fact, the way we need to look at it is this. Accept it. Just accept it. Evil exists, but don't embrace it. Evil exists, accept it, don't embrace it. Ecclesiastes 4:1 says this, again, I saw all the oppression that are done under the sun, and behold the tears of the oppressed, and they had no one to comfort them. That's just wrong. On the side of their oppressors there was power, and there was no one to comfort them. And I thought the dead who are already dead more fortunate than the living who are still alive. Do you see how sad that sounds? What he's saying is, life's not fair. It's better that those people are dead than having to live with this mess. Let me put it into a perspective for you. Our country's not fair. America is not fair. The people that have already died, they're lucky. Now, some of you may go, well, that sounds true. I agree on that one, Pastor. That's what he's saying. It's not a healthy perspective, but it's a truthful perspective. He's saying that in my journey to find balance, I recognize that life is not just all gumdrops and candy corn. Life's not fair. Evil exists. I'm going to accept it. I'm going to recognize it. I'm going to call it for what it is, but I'm not going to embrace it and take it as my own. I'm going to call that evil, not this evil. There is a difference between good and evil. There is a difference between God and Satan. There is a difference between the light and the darkness. We've got to accept it, but not embrace it. We've got to change our perspective, our perception of what balance is. It looks like this. Anybody ever felt spiritual attack? I did right before I got over. Where's Seth? Right before I came up here, I put my hand on Seth. And I said, Seth, you got to pray, man. I feel oppression, man. It's attacking me. Somebody asked me out there, Pastor, why are you holding your chest? Because I felt this oppression. I'm not trying to be weird for those of you that don't understand. You need to understand something, though. That even though things are in balance, even though I'm doing everything I can to, I gotta keep it in balance. I gotta keep my spiritual walk in check. The reality is the enemy's on the other end pressing down. The enemy's on the other side going, I'm gonna mess you up. I'm gonna mess with your emotions. I'm gonna mess with your thoughts. I'm going to spiritually attack you. The evil exists, but I'm on this side going, oh no, I'm gonna fight it. I'm gonna fight it, doggone. We're gonna worship. We're gonna preach. We're gonna spend time in the altars. We're gonna touch heaven. We're gonna fight it. I'm gonna win. I've accepted its existence, but I'm not gonna go, it's not worth fighting. Let me just come hang out over here. It's easier. No more fighting, no more attack, no more spiritual weight. I'll just sit here, it's easier. Friends, our perception. How do you view your enemy? How do you view his attack? Number four, we're looking at Solomon and how his perception changed over time as his life got out of balance and he wrestled with getting back into balance. And we see number four, another powerful truth is that fulfillment is found internally. Fulfillment is found internally. Ecclesiastes chapter 6. Y'all with me? Y'all, you sure? Because what I've learned is this is not one of those messages that people go, woo! No, this is one of those messages you have to take your notes and you have to go home and you've got to get in the Word of God. A dear friend of mine in this room showed me something he's doing. The Holy Spirit led him to do this year, and it blows my mind. He showed me the file where he takes Sunday's messages, and he goes home and he spends a week poring over those notes, reading the scripture, writing his thoughts out, letting the Holy Spirit speak to him. And let me tell you, I've seen more growth in that man in 1 month than I've seen in most Christians in a lifetime. Can I encourage you? Take it a step further beyond the doors. Number four, fulfillment is found eternally. Internally. Ecclesiastes chapter 6 says this: there is an evil that I have seen under the sun, and it lies heavy on mankind. A man to whom God gives wealth, possessions, and honor, so that he lacks nothing of all that he desires. Yet God does not give him power to enjoy them, but a stranger enjoys them. This is worthless. It's a grievous evil. If a man fathers 100 children and lives many years so that the days of his years are many, but his soul is not satisfied with life's good things. Solomon learned something so powerful in the midst of trying to find balance in his relationships, his finances, his priorities, in his lifestyle and the life that he's supposed to be living as a follower of God. He finds out something that is so truthful, but unfortunately we miss it. Is that fulfillment can only be found internally. Friends, there's a people in this room right now that you have stuff, you are set up for success. There's people in this room that you are retired and things are okay, is providing nothing major, catastrophe happens. There's people in this room that are young and you seem like you got it all together. This room is full of people, but there's something else that's in this room. People that if they were honest would say, Pastor, I feel so empty. There's something missing. There's something that's just not jiving. There's something that's not alive inside of me anymore. I'm missing out. The reason is fulfillment can't be found in doing stuff, seeing stuff, owning stuff, possessing stuff. It can only be found internally. That God-shaped void can only be filled by God. It can't be filled by anything else. The fifth thing that we see, and I'm almost done. The fifth thing is that life is finite. Now, some people pronounce that word finite. What it means, though, is this. You're not promised tomorrow. One of the things you may not know about me, and I got a lot. Anybody quirky out there? Just want to make sure I'm not the only one. Anybody sitting next to somebody that's quirky? Let's go that route. Okay, still, I feel alone, but that's fine. I got some quirks about me. And one of the things about, hey, easy, that's not a good place to amen. One of the quirks about me, it's a good and it's a bad thing. One of my number one skill sets, according to all the tests they take, is that I'm a strategist. Everything I do is strategy. I just think strategy. I think 20 steps ahead. I think about every possible outcome. That's just the way my brain works. But the negative is that I can't handle excuses. I'm not good. Like, if you give me excuses, inside of my head, I just want to throw something at you. So if you're like, oh, gosh, have I been giving excuses? Don't worry about it. It's okay. I'm working on it. It's something inside of me. I can't handle excuses. And one of the excuses I hear the most that drives me crazy is this one. You ready? I'll do it tomorrow. I'll get it later. I want to start this devotion, but this isn't a good week. All diets start on what day of the week? Tomorrow, Monday. And if it's Sunday night, you can't start the next day. You have to have emotional preparation, of course. So it's like the next Monday. Diets never get started on Wednesdays. Never. That's why the gyms are always busiest on Mondays. Always. I can't find my machine on Mondays because everybody's there on Mondays. They're not there on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays, or Fridays, though. There's something about us that we want to put things off to tomorrow. We call it procrastination. It's an excuse. When the reality is that we're not promised tomorrow. And a man that had it all together, that had everything he could imagine, that life seemed like it was perfect, in the midst of his imbalance, he realized a truth that's so powerful that we've got to look at it, that life is not promised tomorrow. Life is finite. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, it says this, but all this I laid to heart. All this I laid to heart. Examining it all, how the righteous and the wise and their deeds are in the hand of God. Whether it is love or hate, man does not know. Both are before him. It is the same for all. It is the same for all. Since the same event happens to the righteous and the wicked, to the good and the evil, to the clean and the unclean, to him who sacrifices and him who does not sacrifice, as the good one is, so the sinner. And he who swears is as he who shuns an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun. What's he saying? Everybody's going to die sometime. His perspective was a life of I will obtain and I will collect and I will build and I will develop. I'll do what works for me for all eternity. It amazes me that he died at 52. 52. He ruled from 12 to 52, 40 years. And in the end, he too dies. Why are you telling me this, Pastor? Because all the things that we've talked about, Seth, you can come back. All the things that we've talked about, all the talks about perspective, all the talks about finances and relationships, all the discussion that we've had about living a Christian lifestyle and convictions, all the things that we've spoken about, every topic could come back to this. Life, breath, tomorrow is not promised. And when we're looking at the scales of life and we're looking at the balance beams that run across and we're looking at all the different things that may be out of whack and what have you, when it's all held up to the looking glass of eternity and the value and the perspective of life is not promised, it changes everything. Those relationships all of a sudden just aren't as important. That thing you want to buy all of a sudden is just not that important. That excuse as why not to give all of a sudden is just, it's not that important. When you take it and you look at everything through the looking glass of a finite life, we see something so powerful. Life isn't promised tomorrow. There's people in this room that somewhere along the lines of this conversation about keeping these things in check, keeping these things balanced, I'm willing to bet there's people in this room that have said it. I'm out of balance. I'll start working on it tomorrow. I'll get that in check later. Now's not a good time. Work's not a good time. Family, there's stuff happening in our family. Finance, I'm going to wait till after the financial peace class. I'm going to wait till then to start giving. I'm going to wait till things that slow down at work before I find someone to mentor. I'm going to wait till things get a little bit easier before I find somebody that I can follow. Life isn't promised tomorrow, friends. God's calling us to balance today. To sum it all up, if you go to Ecclesiastes and you look at one of the very last things he says. In fact, many scholars would tag this as his last words. We don't know for sure. But in the storyline of everything, it's assumed that these are some of the last words of Solomon. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13, it says this. The end of the matter. After it's all said and done. This is it. I'm about to step off my soapbox. I'm about to hang up my hat and say I'm done. But before I do, let me say one last thing. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this alone is the whole duty of man. Doesn't that sound familiar? It's the same things his daddy told him 40 years before. 40 years earlier, his dad grabs a hold of him with his dying breath and says, son, keep his commandments. I'm going to make it simple. Learn from my mistakes. Anybody ever told a child that? Learn from my mistakes. I'm going to sum it up. I'm going to simplify it. Just keep his commandments. Follow God. And here's Solomon. Started out just right. And it just slowly crept out of whack. And he comes back to these last words. Keep his commandments. Fear God. See, balance. I don't want to give you the last fill-in because I know you'll put up your notes and turn me off. So just listen. Balance isn't found when things are easy. You don't find balance when all the possibilities fall into line. Balance doesn't just happen because there just all of a sudden is enough money and little debt. Balance doesn't just happen when all these relationships, poof, just show up. Balance doesn't just happen with priorities falling in line all of a sudden. It doesn't just happen. Balance is found in the struggle to find it. I finished these notes earlier in the week, not expecting that I would find myself with a level at our house yesterday. I told you this morning my wife bought this strange piece of furniture for me to mount on a wall. And there was something that jumped out to me in that process. And Faith will tell you it's because I was getting frustrated. But I found out, I realized something that brought this to life. I believe now looking back, it was a God moment. I struggled getting that stupid thing on the wall, didn't I? Faith's like, you're going to put that through the wall if you're not careful. I'm just, put the level here, put the level here, put the level here. And I fought with it. Because you have to understand, if I put something up in my house and it's off just a little bit, I'll go crazy. I'll go plumb crazy. So I had to get it level. It had to be perfect. Not between the outside two lines, but the inside two lines. And I struggled, but I had a sheet of paper. I'm dividing fractions. There's pi in there somewhere, and it's just algorithms. It's craziness. The balance was found in the midst of struggling with it. The balance was found in the struggle. Anybody ever feel like your finances are just a struggle? Anybody ever feel like your relationships are just a struggle to keep balance? Anybody feel like it's a struggle to keep your priorities in balance? My wife and I went this weekend to sign one of our kids up for a sport. It's that time of year. Each one of our kids picks one sport, and they pick different sports. And we were talking. It's like, oh, man, things are about to just drop on the scale and flip everything upside down because now we're going to go from being at home with each other at night to 8 nights a week. Sporting event or practice, you know, because they train these kids up to play NFL when they're 6. And here we are, we're back in the midst of struggling to find balance. Balance is found in the midst of struggle. And I'm saying that because there's so many people here tonight that I believe you're frustrated. I've talked to you, you go, Pastor, I'm just trying, I almost got my finances in balance, and then I got a bill that came in. Pastor, I was putting this relationship thing together, and I was going to talk to so-and-so because she's just pulling me down, and then something happened in her family, and she needed me, And Pastor, I was working so hard to get my lifestyle in balance. In fact, I decided that I was going to remove some of the things that don't need to be there. And then all of a sudden, it's like some friends called me. And balance is found in the struggle. And it's good that you're struggling. Because when you stop struggling, something's about to happen. The best time to learn balance is not when it's easy. It's not tomorrow. It's not next week. The best time to learn the perspective about balance is now. It's today. So with every head up and every eye open, I want to ask you a question. You're good. Get back there, guys. You're good. How many of you would say during this series, the priorities one kind of, Pastor, I'm struggling with some of my priorities. Let me see your hand. Come on, put them up. Put them up. There's hands all the time. Okay, don't lie. Put it up. Put it up high. Now everybody look around at those sinners. Okay, let me ask you a question. How many of you, the relationship one was kind of hitting you? Put your hand up. Come on. Yeah, I heard the conversations at the restaurant. Oh, look at all those sinners. Don't say the one about finances. Don't say the one about finances. How many of you would say, Pastor, the one about finances really hit me? Come on, put them up. Put them up. Look at all. It's more sinners. How many of you this morning, the conversation about Christian lifestyle and living and convictions kind of hit you a little bit? More sinners. Why do you do that, Pastor? To embarrass us? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Because sometimes we need to realize that if David, a man after God's own heart, can get it out of whack, if Solomon, one of the wisest men the Word says has ever been or ever will be, got it out of whack, if we can jump in the New Testament, we can look at people like Paul and the disciples who got it out of whack, then who are we to think that we're not? Balance is about perspective, and perspective has to lead to change. So this is how we're going to close tonight. I have gone way too long, and I apologize. This is how I want to close. I want everybody to stand to your feet. And I want you to take it a step further of uncomfortableness. And I want you to turn to somebody around you. And I want you to tell them the one that you struggle with the most. Priorities, finances, relationships, Christian living. Turn to somebody around you and tell them which one you struggle with the most. That was hard, wasn't it? Oh, gosh. People all up in our mess. Dang those people in our mess. Now, this is how we're going to close. I want us to pray. You want to reach over and touch somebody next to you? That's fine. If they're okay with it. Why don't you just love on somebody and let's pray. And I want you to pray for them. Okay? The person that told you what it is, I want you to pray for them. And I want you to pray that God would give them strength, wisdom, and perspective. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you right now, God. God, and we thank you that you are a God that calls us to greater perspectives. That you're a God that calls us in the midst of our struggle to change our perception. God, I lift up my brother. God, I pray right now that God, you would grow him and develop him in areas of priorities. That God, you would teach him and give him wisdom. That God, he would make decisions to be the man of God that he needs to be. That God, he would put things where they should be and only where they should be. That God, as the enemy tries to attack him, God, I pray that you'd open his eyes to see the things you've called him to, open up his ears to hear the things you've called him to, and God, I pray that you would provoke his heart to forcibly put the things in those places that nothing would stand in the way. God, I lift up everybody in this room. Father, those that said, honestly, Pastor, this is what I'm struggling with. God, I pray that, Father, you would do what only you can. That, Father, you would encourage and you would strengthen and you would provoke. God, I don't want to get lost in the easy. I don't want to get comfortable. I don't want to take the easy road. Your word tells us that narrow is the road. Narrow is the gate. God, I pray that you would make it difficult for us so that, God, we would struggle and we would fight and we would find the perspective that would change our lives, that would change the way we look at things, that would bring things back to the balance that your word teaches us about. That, God, we would assess our priorities, that we would assess our relationships, our finances, our lifestyles, our convictions, and that, God, we would be so uncontrollably provoked to do something about it that we would never be just hearers of the word but also become doers of the word. God, I pray that you would challenge us tonight, challenge us tomorrow. God, that we wouldn't put things off for days to come, but we would deal with it today and become the men and women of God you've called us to be. Father, I thank you for this word. God, I thank you that you're a God that regardless of our imbalance, your grace and your mercy is there to guide us through the process, to wrap your arms around us in your presence. When we feel alone, when we feel out of whack, you're there. If we would just trust you and lean on you. God, I thank you for these people tonight. Thank you for, God, the sacrifices that they make with their time, their resources. God, I thank you for the word. And I pray that it would continue to challenge and provoke us. God, that you would use us, that we would become the men and women of God that you have created us to be, and nothing, nothing less. Open up our eyes to see and our ears to hear. In Jesus' mighty, his holy, and his perfect name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise God. Come on, can we give him a hand clap of praise? Let's just glorify him.